I think one of the biggest lessons I learned during this symposium was from the people who tend to work over long time periods. And what they reminded us is that communities are always in transition. Tamara Tichton talked about the incredibly agro-diverse fields of communities in Fiji. And she said, we know these systems are wonderful and sustainable and resilient because people have lived here for millennia successfully.
Challenges that we face together as a group that have to do with our interface with nature have been unimportant in constructing our brains.
That our hominid lineage has always employed cognition to respond to such challenges, and that to some degree this has always worked. We're still here with our big brains. Learning from our mistakes will often mean considering how to do things differently, and then starting to do things differently. Foresight, modeling, and analysis are examples of the sorts of cognitively difficult means we must harness in this task.
As an archaeologist, I tend to deal with societies that are on a much smaller scale than our current global systems, which are, of course, just immense. It's advantageous to study these small-scale systems, and the challenge then is to understand to what degree, if any, we can take what we learn from observing how these small-scale models behave to scale up for larger systems.
Bringing people together with diverse methodological and theoretical perspectives does not inhibit discovery, it actually fosters creativity.
Our field as researchers, I think we're in flux right now, partly because of the demands of the world itself. We've got a lot more to explain, and systems are more complex than they were even 50 years ago. At the same time, our institutions, our universities and the research institutions in which we work are under a lot of fiscal stress. And yet, I think one of the things we should really remember is how incredibly privileged we are to be able to study this stuff. I mean, one of the things our job does is puts us in contact with communities who are struggling every day to get medicine, to get clean water, to get access to land to plant food on. And that sort of keeps me humble to the fact that the struggles we face, you know, in a global perspective are, they're not trivial, but they need to be put in perspective.
One of the things that I've seen at this conference that's very heartening is that it truly has been boundary spanning with respect to the people who are here. But also, I think, with respect to the problems that we're looking at, because the problems are, in general, very difficult problems. We are now, for the first time, I think, beginning to develop the sorts of mechanistic models, simulation tools, and the like that will allow us to cope with such high levels of connectedness in a fairly disciplined way.
One of the really interesting surprises was the ways in which socio-environmental systems in transition are not necessarily transitioning to some sort of worse stage. A lot of the researchers talked about situations where they were surprised by unexpected outcomes. For example, under stress from market forces, a community starts planting more trees, not less. Or a road gets built and inspires more long-term intensive sustainable agriculture. It's really important, I think, to emphasize those stories where you hear that humans are ingenious, creative, and respond to change in unexpected and often very positive ways.